Unit 2, prevention and hazards. We've talked about the threat of fire, we've talked about the consequences, we've talked about some of the things that we need to know in order to make decisions related to what happens if a fire emergency occurs, but we want to talk about prevention and hazards because I'm convinced that after the realization of the threat in Unit 1, the most important thing we need to know is the information in Unit 2. This gets a little bit more piece by piece, bit by bit, what actions do I actually take than the first component. The first component, more awareness, this more actual procedures or actual things that we need to know and do. But I think this is the most important issue following the realization of the threat. Most of you are probably either from a chemistry class or a fire service training or somewhere familiar with a fire tetrahedron. There are four things that are required for a fire to begin and be sustained. There is a need for fuel. You have to have something that will burn, and that can be literally anything in your residence where you live. You need heat enough to raise the fuel to its ignition temperature. And some of the things we're going to talk about might surprise you about what types of things will provide that heat, where that spark or where that temperature rise can occur and actually ignite something that will cause a fire in your residence. The third piece of that is oxygen, and oxygen enough to support combustion. Those of you who are really old like me and know what a carburetor is on a vehicle know that you had to have the gasoline to fuel or gasoline to air mixture correct or else it didn't burn. If it was too rich and you had too much gasoline, it didn't burn. If you had too much oxygen and not enough fuel, it didn't burn. So all of those things have to be in the right proportions in order for them to come together and cause the chemical chain reaction or that ongoing process by which the fire is sustained. So we need all of those things. When we talk about fire prevention, the issue of fire prevention is in some way preventing those three things from coming together and causing the fire. If I don't have the fuel in proximity to the ignition source, the fire doesn't start and I prevented the fire. If I don't have an oxygen source where I am supporting that, I mean obviously the oxygen in the air, but if I can remove that oxygen from that fire component, I've prevented or extinguished the fire. So we need to keep those three things separated in a way that will not allow the fire to occur. Now, in the residences, in the places where you work, in the places where you do inspections, those kind of things, what might be some sources of fuel in those type of settings?
Any part of it.
Any part of it? Literally, almost anything that's there, right? Could be that fuel source. Now, some of those things take a much higher ignition temperature than others. A piece of paper, crumpled paper on the desk, is going to ignite much more quickly than a piece of plywood, which may be used for roofing material. 2x4, you can't even buy a 2x4 anymore, but whatever they cut them to now, a 2x4 is much less likely to initially ignite than wood shavings, those kind of things. So there's a disparity in what it may take to actually begin the fire, but anything that you have at some point will burn. Anything could be a consumable. What about ignition sources? What are some things that might start the fire?
Electrical
wiring.
Gas. And is that a gas thing over in, what was it, New York here, where that house blew up there?
Yes, that was about 40 miles from my house in Salem where the house exploded. And there was another one two nights ago. And I can't remember where it was, but it was on Channel 6 and 13. It was a local news issue where a house exploded. They believe that in Salem there was a propane leak, and they don't know yet what ignited that, but there was enough propane in the house that it actually ignited and blew the thing, and it looked like a tornado had gone through. There was nothing standing and no pieces left that were recognizable. It was just incredible the way that happened. Okay, so propane, natural gas, those kind of things?
Improper storage of gasoline or flammable liquids such as paint thinners.
Okay. All right.
Hobby. Cigarettes.
Yes.
Candles,
cigarettes. All right.
Okay. Linton dryers.
Linton dryers. Okay. Just a multitude of things. If you stand in the middle of any room in your residence and you do this, you do a circle and you look around, you say, that'll burn, that'll burn, that'll burn, that'll burn, and there's an ignition, there's an ignition, there's an ignition. So it takes some diligence in order to, as we said, prevent the fire by keeping those things separated or keeping those things confined in their safe areas.
Air temperature also
if it gets warm enough, spontaneous combustion?
Spontaneous combustion can happen. Spontaneous combustion is more the product that itself creating the heat that ignites it. Linseed oil and rags, those kind of things, are actually as a process within oily rags, which itself generates enough heat to be able to ignite itself or ignite its own product. But yes, as far as temperatures, there was a fueling facility up home last week that actually had the auto ignition, the dry chemical ignition system over the fuel pumps, go off. And the reason was that it was so hot, the temperature in the canopy got to a point where it activated the dry chemical system and dumped on the pumps. And that was about a $20,000 refill. But anyway, be that as it may. But yes, the temperatures and some of those kind of things. Chris, how many grass and brush fires have you been to where the fire was ignited by somebody dropped their eyeglasses, or there was some kind of a piece of glass in the sun? A broken bottle. The sun was refracted in a way that it actually caused the ignition of the fire. So yeah, all of those kind of things. Fire prevention goals. What is it that we want to accomplish by fire prevention? There are three goals in any life safety issue, and they're always the same and always in the same order. Number one is life safety. The primary goal of all of our fire safety efforts is to protect the building occupants from death and injury. That's number one. Everything else we do is secondary to that. We need to preserve life. And if we prevent the fire from occurring, we have made the most important step in keeping people from being injured or killed. Number two is property conservation. As we all know, buildings are extremely expensive. The replacement of those is a huge, huge, huge expense. So our second goal is try to prevent property damage. And we'll talk about a couple of illustrations of how those things played together in a few minutes, probably in section three or unit three. And then finally, continuity of operations. If we can prevent the fire from occurring, we don't have to go back and try to figure out where are we going to house our consumers while we do repairs, or possibly even where do we permanently relocate them and the whole disruption that is. I mean, even for a family in the general population, for them to lose a home and have to relocate and start over in a new location and those kind of things is problematic and an emotional trauma that becomes even greater in the world in which you work. So life safety, property conservation, and continuity of operations. And I would suggest to you the best time to fight a fire is before it starts. All of the things we've talked about by way of consequence, all of the things we've talked about by way of death and injury, the property loss, the $15 billion in property loss every year in the United States, all of those things virtually go away if the incident never starts in the first place. So the best fire is the one that never starts. I take some heat for that in the office sometimes because we are the Office of Fire Prevention and Control. And the history of the fire service world is that everybody focuses on the control, and there's been minimal focus on the prevention piece. But if we truly want to live up to our oath, if we truly want to provide for safety and preservation of life and reduction of property loss, the most important, the most effective, the most cost-effective way for that to occur is through fire prevention. If we keep the incident from happening in the first place, we never have to deal with what happens on the other end. The most important firefighting anybody can do, sell that to a guy whose income is based on putting them out. It's a little tough, but they're more and more, the fire service is realizing, because of budget cuts, because of the lack of funding that's available for manpower, for vehicles, all those kind of things, the fire service is coming finally to the point of realizing that prevention needs to be their primary focus. It needs to be what they do first. Fire trucks, axes, helmets, turnout gear, all of those kind of things, if these are needed, it's already too late. Anything after the fire starts is just an attempt to reduce the magnitude of the consequences. The bad thing has already happened. Something has burned, somebody's hurt. All we can do is try to keep it from getting any worse or try to keep others from being involved. If we can prevent the fire from happening, we don't have to get there. We don't have that loss. We've prevented all of that if we take the prevention track. Fire is understandable. We know, we already talked about fire development. We already talked about the fire tetrahedron. Fire is understandable. We know what causes fire. We know how it progresses and how it develops. It's predictable. We know that if certain things happen, there will be a fire. We know that if certain things happen, the fire will extend, that there will be expansion of it. We know what the consequences of fire will be if it occurs. It's understandable. We know exactly what it is and how it works. It's predictable. We know where it's going and what the consequences are. And because of that, it's preventable. As I said before, 90%, I believe 90% of all of the fire deaths in the United States did not have to happen because we understand fire, it's predictable, and we could have done something to keep those deaths from occurring. What are some potential hazards? We've already talked about some of those when we talked about ignition sources, things that may ignite a fire in your residence or things that may contribute to the spread of the fire in your residence. Cooking, everybody does that in almost every one of your facilities. Misuse of electricity, very, very common, one of the leading causes. Cooking is the number one cause of fire in the general population. Electricity also is number two. Heating issues, open flame, candles were mentioned, smoking was mentioned, and we need to make the statement at this point that OPW's policy at this point is there is no smoking. All right. However, if we extend to the voluntaries and some of the supportive living type configurations or models, that may not always be the case in everywhere we are, so we'll look at that briefly. And then housekeeping issues, and we'll talk about some of those things. What about cooking? Well, any cooking that you do has the potential for raising an ignition temperature to the point of igniting a fire. Whether it's a range, gas range with an open flame, whether it's a heating unit with an electrical element that raises the temperature, any of them have the potential of raising the temperature of a fuel to the point of ignition and causing a fire. Now, everybody, or usually somebody in a class, will talk about safety elements, SAF-T elements. They're electrical stove elements that actually have thermocouplers and technology built into the unit, which when replaced for a regular heating element in a stove, can prevent most of the fires that occur related to an electric range. The reason is that they never get to a temperature high enough to ignite the fuel source, or they shut off prior to that ignition point. I've seen demonstrations of these. We promote them highly in the college world, where students are less than careful with what they're cooking when they get home at 3 o'clock in the morning and decide they want a hot dog or whatever it may be. But the safety element, and I'm not promoting a product, I'm just making you aware that there are a couple of those things out there. They actually lay paper towels on them, and the paper towel will scorch, it'll turn brown, but never actually ignite on the electrical element in the range. And there are a couple of companies doing those. So something you might want to look at, or something that could be considered. One of the big issues with cooking and ranges and open flames especially, and traditional heating elements and electric ranges, is that they have to be cleaned. In the normal residence, that is not often the case. People tend to just let things build up, and the greases and all of those kind of things contribute to the likelihood of a fire occurring. Never leave cooking unattended, and I understand that in the world where you live, that is probably fairly unrealistic. But in some way, remember that you have something going.
Okay? We train the staff to turn it along, because what will happen is you're cooking in one room, you get screaming in the other room, you got to, the reality is you got to leave. Mm-hmm. So then what do? Because the problem is they often leave the flames on, they leave the stove on, that's the mistake. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So they can't always can't watch it turn it off.
Right. Right. Good point. Good solution to that, because the reality is that you will be called away. Turn it off, keep track of that, but never leave the flame unattended. And keep combustible materials away. Also a frequent problem, paper towel rolls, whatever, dishcloths, those kind of things that get laid close to whatever. A bottle of cooking oil, yeah, whatever that combustible may be close to the heat source. Never wear loose-fitting clothing, and I'm sure some of you actually have consumers that are involved in the cooking process or that you help with that. This is important for them. A lot of time, housecoat, bathrobe kind of things, or or loose-fitting long-sleeve clothing where it touches the flame or gets involved with the heating piece, and the clothing will actually ignite, common source of injury for burn victims. And unplug appliances when not in use, probably not something we routinely think of, but toaster ovens, those type of hot plates, George Foreman grills, whatever they may be, if we unplug them, we don't have the potential for that heat source becoming the ignition source for a fire. Make sure appliances are cool before storing or covering. We had a fire just recently up home where somebody decided that they were going to take their Foreman grill and immediately before they went outside to the picnic table to eat the burgers, put it in the cupboard. And it was still hot. It was hot enough that it ignited the product next to it, ignited the cupboard, which went into the wall, and they lost the kitchen. Kitchen. Good stop. Room and contents, right? But crock pots can be... They're designed for that. If they're working properly, that works. But again, you don't want to put them away in a cupboard where there's something combustible where you might be putting that heat source. Check the oven before turning it on and don't use it for storage. Again, great, great Tupperware cabinet, right? Things get put in ovens a lot of times and people forget they're there. They turn the oven on and whatever that material that's been stored in there becomes the fuel for the fire. Special considerations for barbecue grills, and we were specifically asked to add this component because many of the homes have barbecue grills and have had problems with barbecue grills, so keep them well away from the building. If it's raining, under the awning is not a good place for the barbecue grill in spite of the fact that it's wet. Maintain a combustible-free space around the grill on the standard. The standard number for that is at least 36 inches in all directions. More than that is better, but at least 36 is the recommended distance. Never use under a building overhang or covering, in a garage, in a shed, and the carbon monoxide is an issue with that as well as the possible ignition source, and again, never leave them unattended. It's easy for someone to step in and not know that it's burning or other components of that which allow for accidental ignition of some fuel source. What about electricity? We want to make sure that we don't overload receptacles and the electrical supply. How do we know if something is overloading the electrical supply or an outlet? What are some indicators? Okay, break a circuit breaker. And what's the normal thing? If a circuit breaker trips, what do we normally do?
Reset it.
And an hour later when it trips again, what do?
Reset.
Reset it. If the circuit breaker is tripping, there's a reason why it's tripping. Potentially it's an overload or some kind of problem in the circuit.
And to fix is nothing, put a bigger breaker on it.
Correct. That's right. That's right. Going back to being really old again, I grew up in the days of fuses. And if you had a cartridge fuse, you put a penny in it, and copper's a conductor, and you just bypass the fuse completely? Not a good answer. Yeah, good point. It's not just a bigger breaker. What are some other indicators that the circuit may be overloaded or we need to do something different with the electricity?
The wires are warm.
The wires are warm. Exactly right. If I plug in an appliance and the wire is warm to the touch, it's too much. There's a problem with the electrical system. The resistance in that wire has been affected, and that becomes a heat source. That wire can raise to a temperature where it will ignite carpeting or furniture or whatever ounce may be in the area of that wire. What ounce might be an indicator?
You turn the TV on and the lights go off.
That's a little dramatic, but yes, exactly right. If every time the air conditioner starts, the house lights dim and come back because there's a surge of electricity required to initially start that appliance or apparatus. If it dims the lights or if there's a drop in amperage across the entirety of the house or the lights dim, those kind of things, that's an indication that you have too much on that circuit. Exactly right. One plug per receptacle is the rule. Triple taps, not a good idea.
Say that again.
Triple taps. We can make one outlet three. I actually saw a pretty bizarre situation the other day, not horribly uncommon, but there was one of the triple taps in the outlet. And then somebody had put two more triple taps into the outside outlets of the triple tap. So they had seven things plugged into a single receptacle. And when I say receptacle, I'm talking about the individual little face that National Grid or NYSEG or whoever puts on there when they make their little face out of the thing. Each one of those can be wired separately, so it's a separate circuit. But one plug per receptacle is the rule.
You would address surge strips. Was maybe six options within one strip?
Yes, we can talk about that. I think we're going to get there. If the cord is warm, it's overloaded. Fuses blow, breakers break, lights dim. That's all overload. Let's just do the power strip thing right now. I can go to Lowe's or Home Depot or Walmart or wherever, and I can pay $3.75 for what is called a power strip. And what that is an extension cord with a multiple outlet, multiple receptacle piece on the end, and it may or may not have a power switch to turn all of that on and off. If you pay $3.75 for that, you'll get $3.75 worth of electrical function and safety. If I pay $14.95 for my circuit breaker power strip, I now have $14.95 worth of electrical circuitry and safety and prevention. Power strips are an interesting unit. What the code says is that they need to be circuit breaker protected so that the strip itself has an overload break. Otherwise, it's just an extension cord with the same, it's exactly the same net effect as the triple tap or whatever would be that you put in the outlet. So what we do is in the world in which we live and the inspections we do, those types of things, they have to be circuit breaker protected. Even in that context, you still need to look at all of those other things. Are we dimming lights? Are we heating up cords? All of those kind of things still have to be analyzed or evaluated in the use of those strips.
That flip strip, that's just an on and off switch.
Yes, correct. Yes. Yeah, this is nothing more than a lot more outlets on a single.
So it has to be a reset button?
Yes. There has to be a breaker.
Yes, the UL in the strip.
Yes. And the UL rating is the issue. The $3.75 one that you buy is some offshore piece that may or may not. We've actually taken courses in recognizing UL counterfeits because there are a lot of things coming into country. That's a billions of dollar a year business bringing in offshore product with fake UL labels. So you need to be really careful of that. I don't often say this, but in this context, you really do kind of get what you pay for in the use of those. But yes, that's just an on-off switch on the one on the left. So as we look at our electrical, inspect and make sure that we don't use damaged wires. If there is something that is damaged, you think it's repairable, make sure that you get a qualified person to repair it. Duct tape is not an electrical protection. As good as it is for putting cars together or whatever you do with duct tape, it is not electrical tape. Make sure that you get somebody qualified to make those repairs and take anything out of service if there's any kind of damage. The one on the left-hand side, grounded plug. And what they have done is we don't have a three-prong outlet where we want to plug this in. So we just break off that little round one. And then the two go in and it works fine. That grounding is there for a reason. Make sure that remains intact and is used. And if you don't have a grounded outlet, have an electrician put one of those in. This can be a big issue. Use only the recommended wattage bulb in the fixtures that you have. It's very, very, very common to go to the closet to get a replacement bulb and not have a 40 watt, so I throw a 75 or 100 in. And the net result of that is overheating. The lamps are actually designed for the wattage that they rate them at, and to use more than that, depending on the product or even the position. If you look at the blue one in the middle, the problem with that is that all of the heat from that bulb is contained within the shade or within that housing. So every bit of heat that bulb generates is inside of that. So if that's rated at 40 watts, they have determined that product will take the heat of a 40 watt bulb. You put a 100 watt bulb in there and triple the heat of that bulb, that material no longer retains its properties in the context of that kind of heat. So the rating on the bulb is an important issue. Make sure that we keep those within the recommended wattage. Portable generators, I think most of us are probably familiar with some of the dangers of portable generators. One is carbon monoxide. We need to make sure that we don't place them where that carbon monoxide is going to enter a window or inside a room or a building. That's fairly obvious. But also the generators generate heat, so combustible materials that get next to an exhaust system or an engine can cause fire, and also the electrical issues of that. Many fires have been started because the generator has backfed into the system within the house and caused overload or shorts or things that have caused fires. So we need to make sure that the house is wired for that generator, wired properly, that there are actually transfer switches so we can't have it on the generator and the street source at the same time. All of those things, again, it all comes back to make sure that if you're going to do some kind of modification or you're going to add some kind of system or you're going to do some kind of repair, make sure that you have a professional who's qualified to do that, make those things happen. Fueling them, fuel storage. We have a college up north which is specifically related to education in the area of forestry. And the folks who work in the forestry industry, one of their primary tools is a chainsaw. And in a college dormitory with 75 people living in the college dormitory, and it's a wood frame structure, my chainsaw is extremely important to me. So I store my chainsaw in my room, and I store the gasoline for my chainsaw in the corridor. Not a good idea. So where we fuel them, where we put the fuel, and those kind of things all becomes very important. If we're working with generators, we need to make sure we have a location apart from the residence where the storage takes place, where fueling takes place, where the generator runs, those types of things. Yes, ma'am.
Is there a distance to keep the fuel away from the residence? Is there a distance?
Not really. It's more the containment than it is a distance per se. Certified container, make sure that it's a registered, again, going back to UL, make sure it's a tested registered container, and then just away from, so it's not inside the building. Or if it's in a storage facility, if it's a concrete shed or something, or whatever you can do to protect the building from that. But it's not so much a distance as it is the containment. Heating related to furnaces, make sure that the scheduled cleaning and maintenance take place. Many heating fires are related to failure to take care of cleaning and those kind of things. We come back to that 36-inch rule. The standard is 36 inches away from the combustibles. We need to make sure that the heat source is kept from things that will burn. And then remember that heating furnaces are a carbon monoxide source. Very often we don't think of the fact that a water heater is also a source of ignition. We need to make sure that they are well maintained. We need to make sure that the electrical supply to them and the electricity and the wiring within them is maintained, and the integrity of that is kept in place. If it's a gas or oil-fired water heater, carbon monoxide is again an issue. So we need to make sure that we keep them maintaining. Maintenance is one of the biggest issues. What happens is if the sediment starts to build up in the bottom of the heater, the lower element isn't heating water anymore. It's the heat is being contained by that product that has been deposited in the bottom of the water heater. The temperatures change, the materials around the heating elements change, and all of those things can contribute to an ignition source. Space heaters, major fire problem in many types of private residences. Space heaters placed too close to combustible materials. People don't follow the instructions for how they're supposed to be used. They leave them on for hours or days at a time. They contain them in something that keeps the heat close. There's not airspace enough for the heat to dissipate. All of those things can contribute to ignition of a fire. The best thing to do is follow the manufacturer's instructions and make sure that the space heater you're using has a no tip, or if it does tip over, there's an automatic shutoff that prevents that from igniting the materials around it. Candles, not allowed unless the wick is removed. It's the only way you can assure that the open flame of the candle is not being used. What's really cool nowadays, there are several companies that are doing flameless candles, and some of them look really real. In fact, if you're doing the candle burning for the sake of the scent, some of them smell very much like the flame candles. So there are some alternatives out there, much, much safer. It's a light bulb that looks like a flame, and some of those things work really well. Somebody before mentioned hobbies. There are a lot of components of consumer hobbies that we need to keep track of very closely. The tools that we use, hot glue guns, wood burning tools, those type of things. And then the products that we use them with, some of the solutions, paint thinners, paints, some of those kind of things, some of the glues, some of the cement things that we use for some of the hobbies.
Yes, sir. Going back to the candle, what about like flame plugins? I've heard different things about them.
There is some evidence that there have been a good number of those that have caused fires because of breakdown within the unit itself. It's an electrical appliance. It really is. It's plugged into a receptacle, and there's electricity passing through that. And there is some evidence. I don't actually have the statistics in the report, but at least anecdotally, and I believe beyond that, there is evidence that they do have some of those that have caused fairly significant fires. Okay? So the hobby issues, the materials used, those kind of things, something to monitor, keep track of, make sure that we know what's happening with those, supervise those things. And then smoking, again, not permitted in state residences. But again, if you get into the supportive living things models, that may be something that is a little bit different in those areas or those types of residences.
It's not allowed inside, they're allowed to smoke.
Right. And in that context, we start talking about distances from buildings, how far away, what do we do with it, who is supervising or monitoring the fact that the materials are actually put out. We have a story that we have received where the fire started within the, what are they called, the outpost, I believe, is the term for the outside ashtray with a post on top, okay? Smoker's outpost, okay? In the smoker's outpost is where the fire started, and what happened is it hadn't been cleaned, it hadn't been emptied, and there were a whole lot of butts in the base of that, and when a cigarette that was not extinguished was put into that, it ignited that material within the base of the outpost. Well, nobody noticed it for a while. It was close enough to the residence that it actually melted the outpost, melted the siding, and the fire extended and climbed the wall. So even in those you can smoke outside kind of context, there needs to be supervision and some care taken with those kind of things. Proper receptacles, and obviously never smoking in bed, upholstered furniture. If we take them outside, that issue goes away. Make sure the ashes are cold before dumping, even in those outposts. If you take that and just dump it into something where there's a combustible material, you've probably started a fire. Housekeeping. Probably one of the bigger issues related to the residences where you work. Just normal things that kind of get away from you because it's not a dramatic, all of a sudden we've got too much of something or all of a sudden something is really dirty, but it's sort of an ongoing little by little progression that doesn't seem bad and we kind of get used to and it just progresses and nobody's really paying attention and taking care of. So the housekeeping issues can be one of the really big parts of this. Clothes dryers. Washers and dryers are a key component of every one of your residences in some way or another. Many of your houses actually will be running them multiple times a day. So they become very, very important. We need to make sure that they are plugged into the proper type of receptacle. There is special wiring for dryers because of the temperature and the amperage draw and those type of things. The amperage is much higher than a regular circuit. We need to make sure the circuit is right, that the outlet is right, that we haven't done anything by way of adapters or something to plug it into a different kind of receptacle. We need to make sure that it's not going to overload the electrical system. If the lights dim when you turn the dryer on, rewiring is required. Make sure that we keep track of all of those kind of things. Lint filters. I've done 7 dryer loads today, and I just don't want to pull the lint filter out one more time. This is a full filter. What that lint is actually tiny fibers of fabric, which are combustible material. Dryers run hot. That's how they dry, is the circulation of the clothes or whatever it is in the air in a heated environment. Those tiny fibers ignite easily. Most dryer fires are related to the lint filter issue. Either the lint has gotten into the exhaust pipe or the vent pipe for the dryer, or the lint filter itself has not been cleaned, and that's where the dryer fires start. There was a fire in a residence where there had not been the maintenance that necessarily should have taken place, and the dryer belt began to wear, and because there was a problem with the pulleys not operating correctly, and instead of the pulley turning and the belt turning on the pulley actually was stopping at times, so the belt was rubbing on the pulley and being dragged across the pulley as opposed to the pulley rolling with it. And the temperature from that friction on the pulley got to such a point that it ignited the lint. That's what caused the fire. So again, maintenance issues. We need to make sure that they're in working order, that we check them regularly, serviced as needed, and the biggest issue is make sure that we clean the lint out of the filters. Inspect the filters for damage, make sure that cleaning is taking place, and replace them if necessary.
Can I make a comment about the pulley? That pulley is not operating right. It'll make a lot of noise.
Yes.
That'll be a cue for you that something's wrong.
Squeak, squeal, rattle.
Squeal.
Yep.
That happens
to me. How often do you recommend cleaning the back pulleys?
At least annually. Now, that's at least annually is in the context of a private residence, which means that a couple times a week I'm running a dryer load. If you're doing three or four a day, you need to back that off or step that up to compensate for the number of times it's been. The vent pipe, again, the code is for a regular residential property at least annually. In the context of what you do with multiple loads a day, those kind of things, you need to step that up and do it much more often. But that lint builds up. Again, if the filter is working correctly, this problem is reduced, but it doesn't go away. We still need to make sure that we clean those vent pipes of that lint buildup. And one of the indicators of that is taking longer than normal to dry clothes because the air, that air circulation that you have, isn't occurring correctly. That's being impeded, and because that's being impeded, it's taking longer for the drying to take place. Routinely confirm that the outside vent is open while drying, and one of the things that Perry just mentioned was snow buildup, accumulation. Where I live, 14-inch snowstorm is not unusual, and if my dryer vent is 12 inches off the ground, it's not going to work until of course it gets hot enough and melts the snow away, and then better idea to clean it out, right? Or the house burns, yeah. But make sure that we keep those things clear. Make sure we check the outside vents. They're off very often for the sake of rodent protection to keep cold air or whatever from coming in. There's a little flapper there or some kind of a automatic closure that closes over the end of it, and when the dryer is running, it's blowing air past that and opens that flap. Make sure that is actually functioning correctly and not stopping your airflow. The area around the dryer, behind the dryer, needs to regularly be checked, and make sure that we keep combustibles away from those things. This dryer fire actually started because there were several socks and pieces of clothes that had gotten behind the dryer, and when the temperature and the heating element got to be such, it ignited the things behind it. The people didn't actually find it for about 4 hours after the fire started because it smoldered for a while in the back before flame actually opened up and got to the point of where it lit enough for became evident enough that they actually saw that the fire was occurring. So again, we need to keep those things safe distance. Housekeeping, cleaning is a big issue. Gas dryers, again, gas dryers are a carbon monoxide source. We need to take that into account, and we need to make sure that they're inspected regularly according to manufacturer's instructions by a professional who can take care of whatever gas issues and valves and those kind of things need to happen. Synthetic materials like plastic, rubber, foam in dryers, that can be an issue with bed pads, those types of things that we want to dry. We need to be extremely careful, make sure that they are rated in a way that they will be able to be done in this fashion. Never dry items that have come in contact with flammables like cooking oil, gasoline, paint thinner, and alcohol. Seems pretty obvious, but it's not obvious. Obvious isn't obvious. We need to mention those kind of things. And that's what happened here. This was a mechanic, and that is his garage. Personal mechanic. I mean, he was just working on his own car. But as he did that, he had some clothes that he had gotten gasoline on and tossed them in the dryer, and this is the result. Never leave the dryer running while away from the house or while sleeping. Again, needs to be monitored, needs to be controlled. Exhaust fans and hoods, if you have those in your residences related to cooking, need to be maintained. There is actually an inspection schedule related to commercial type hood systems that you may have in your residences. That's not the case for the private ones that you'd buy at a home supply store that you might put in over just a regular kitchen range, like a residential range. But those still need to be maintained. They still build up grease. They still have problems with the electrical lighting and the fans, the bushings and the fans, those kind of things, which can create problems and overheating within those hoods. So maybe even more so, the commercial ones are on a regularly scheduled progression of when that needs to happen, and they get tagged, and everybody knows that we have to call the service. The ones that are not commercial rated and do not have that prescribed inspection and maintenance program, they might be all the more important to keep track of and routinely inspect and clean and take care of those kind of issues. Trash and refuse buildup, very easy to do, very common, especially in sort of out-of-the-way spaces. Anything we can do to reduce the combustible fire load, the materials that will burn in a fire incident, is to our advantage. Anything we can do to make those things disappear, anything we can do to keep clean open spaces, makes the likelihood of the fire starting less and makes the likelihood of the fire spreading less as well. Decorations and vegetation. We've probably all seen the Christmas tree videos where the tree is ignited and in a matter of a minute it's just like this explosive flame, the natural vegetation kind of things. Decorations, Halloween, Christmas, all of those holidays. We like to do things to make it homey. We like to do things to allow our consumers to have a personal touch in all of this. We need to be careful what we use to make that happen, because all of those things are combustible, and many of them in the world of crepe papers and those type of things are highly combustible if they're not treated or rated. So we just need to make sure what those products are, how we use them, where we place them in relationship to possible ignition sources and those kind of things. This is huge. Exiting must be kept clear. Unobstructed path of travel is how the code defines it. It's very easy to put something in a corridor. It's very easy to put something next to a door which actually moves into the space designed for exiting. We need to make sure that we keep egress paths clear. In a fire emergency, we already talked about it being hot, dark, smoke and gases, all of those things that are going on in the fire. Our ability to get out being exaggerated or being impeded by those kind of things, or our mental state being conflicted, or our mental state being compromised because of those kind of things going on around us, having something in the way of that exit path, or having something that we might trip over, or having something that makes the door just a little bit narrower, all of those things make it less likely that we're going to survive in a fire emergency. And sadly, you cannot ignore deliberately set fires. There are reports across all of NFPA and across all of the USFA about fires in residential board and care facilities where a disgruntled staff member, a family member that didn't think they were getting what they were supposed to from the program, individual residents or intruders, people breaking into the property, have set the fire. So we need to be careful that we're watchful for those kind of things. If something looks strange, or if something looks like, okay, there's a burn spot over here, we don't know where that came from, monitor those things, watch for progression, make sure that you keep track of the potential for a deliberately set fire. I'm a fire guy. I like trucks, I like hoses, I like turnout gear, I like the heat and the excitement and all of that kind of stuff. But there's no glory in fighting a fire that could have been prevented. If we could have kept it from happening in the first place, there's no glory of saving four rooms and burning up one when we could have saved it all. So we need to make prevention our priority, because one death is too many if it could have been prevented. Questions? Comments? Yes?
Isn't there specifics on the types of hoses that you feed on dryers?
Yes. There are. In fact, in commercial settings commercial settings, residential settings in R2, our occupancies, which would be dormitory or housing type facilities, you actually can't use the flexible hose anymore, because each one of those ripples, if you will, within the hose is a place where lint can collect and get trapped in that hose. So yes, there are straight pipe metal requirements within commercial and multiple residential occupancies.
Used the line before with the surge protectors, you get what you pay for. You kind of see that with appliances as well, dryers and things. The lower quality appliances will be subject to failure and more of a hazard than the higher quality.
So, I think so. It's related to every component of that. The likelihood of the bushings and bearings going bad and causing that friction with the pulleys, what kind of wiring, what gauge wiring they use within it. Again, a big issue that we're coming into a lot in fire investigations is the counterfeit UL or counterfeit testing labs. There's a lot of offshore stuff. And like I said, it's billions and billions of dollars that come in. If you buy just a regular 14-gauge extension cord at the local store, it is likely not truly a UL-listed product at this point in time. But there's a lot of that stuff coming in.
So. I just want to mention also on exiting, furniture placement is a big issue because yes. I went into several homes, and with a little adjustment, the furniture would really have been out of the path. Just by just thinking that through as compared to pushing things around the room to making them so expanded that they're real blocking exits to front doors and stuff. So it's just a consideration that when you're looking at even furniture placement, it can have an impact on blocking an exit.
Good point. Go around your home, just take a look and say, if I had to leave from here, wherever you happen to be standing, if I had to leave from here, how clear is my path to whatever exits I need to get to? Good point. Yes.
We had an interesting experience last night with the fire department. They came in and did a visit. They observed one of our evacuations, and 10 of them came into the kitchen and sat down, and we went over the entire residence, you know, where the exits are, where the bedrooms are, where do we store our chemicals, and, you know, it was a nice conversation. And then they came back next month, and they're not going to do an evacuation, but what they're going to do with the full deployment of all their equipment. They're going to pull in all the trucks, they're going to roll out all the hoses, they're going to hook up to the hydrants. And, you know, they've asked us to, you know, take a look at that just so that we've got an idea of what it's going to look like if we were having it. And it's just one of those elements that you just don't, you know, this is our safe area. You might not be able to commit to your safe area.
Sure. In the fire. It's huge. And we'll talk about that in the next unit. That fire department interaction is a huge, huge piece.